Today we'll be talking with an expert and a mom on the nature of transracial adoptions, why they remain on the increase, what some of the challenges might be, and some suggestions for dealing with the complicated aspect of raising a transracial family. Jeanette Yoffe earned her master's in clinical psychology, focusing on children in foster care and adoption, and earned that from Antioch University. Jeanette's desire to become a child therapist with a special focus on adopted and foster care issues derived from her own experience of being adopted and moving through the foster care system. In 2006, she won Los Angeles Foster Care Hero Award for her dedication to children and families in foster care. Melanie Elliott is a mom, wife, blogger. She calls herself executive director of the Elliott Family Residence, and she's currently seeking a new position in nonprofit development. Melanie writes about parenting and life as a transracial international adoptive parent in her blog, Mom to the Littlest E. So welcome.
Thank you.
Good to be here.
Good to have you. Jeanette, this appears to be one of the hottest topics of our day, race relations in the U.S. I can't think of a more relevant topic for us. Please provide us with some stats to offer the listeners a context for just our ensuing discussion.
Sure. The latest research from the United States Department of Health and Human Services found as of March 31st, 2015, there are currently 1,782,000 children adopted in the United States. 40% of those adoptions are transracial.
Wow.
That is, it's incredible. And
wow.
That is a 25% increase since 2001. It's incredible.
What would you attribute the increase in numbers to?
Well, there are less Caucasian children available for adoption, only 37% currently. And most adoption, well, there are some adoption agencies that do not accept singles or applicants over 40 to adopt.
So what are some of the reasons that parents adopt children from another race?
When I talk with families, some of them feel particularly connected to a culture or race due to their own ancestry or through personal experiences traveling to a certain country and falling in love with that country. And really recognize that children need families to adopt them. I just heard staggering statistics. In India, there's 43 million orphans in India alone that need homes. And more families are diverse today. There's gay and lesbian families, and they're more open to adopting a child from another race because they understand diversity. They're well-skilled in understanding racism and prejudices, and they take pride in being different and adopting and creating a family through adoption that is not the unique family today.
Sure. Melanie, why did you choose to pursue a transracial adoption?
Well, we live in Los Angeles, and in Los Angeles, it's a diverse community made up of a massive melting pot of a whole bunch of different cultures. And my husband's family and my family, there are interfaith marriages and interracial marriages. So, you know, my sister married a Jamaican man and she has a Jamaican son. So there's a lot of diversity within our own families. So we knew that if we went down this path, that would be accepted, appreciated, and embraced by both of our families and our community at large.
And what was the response from your family and from your friends?
Well, our journey to our son took 6.5 years with infertility, and then we had started the adoption from another country, which took too long. It was extended and extended and extended. And we weren't getting any younger, so that's how we ended up doing a concurrent adoption. So by the time we adopted our son from Ethiopia, everybody was just so excited that we actually had a child to love that everyone embraced us. So they welcomed our son, they welcomed our family structure, and once we brought our son home, my husband and I looked at each other and said, "We're good. This is our family." And so we didn't even pursue the other adoption. So that it all worked out great.
How do you feel that people react to you when they see you?
Well, it's interesting. I think as we were new parents, we were, I want to say, just sort of a little bit more obvious because I don't think that has to do with the racial thing. I think it has to do with being new at parenting. And it's sort of like I gave birth, but I didn't give birth. I adopted a 19-pound, 12-and-a-half-month-old baby, and all of a sudden I'm new. And so I think the biggest challenge at being a new parent is just feeling comfortable being a parent, and then being a conspicuous family, learning to incorporate that into the world at large. So our son's been home with us for 5 years, and it's sort of like, this is just who we are, what we are, and nobody really, sometimes we get looks, but it's not anything that we draw attention to. So I think we've gotten used to it, at least as our family, gotten used to being a conspicuous family over time.
What's the most positive aspect of choosing transracial adoption?
The most positive aspect of adoption in general is I get to be a mom to an amazing little boy. Mm-hmm. And I can't imagine him not being my son. I love him as if, I gave birth to him. I think adding the transracial aspect to it, I think my life is bigger and exponentially fuller because of that layered aspect, not only with the transracial, but also with the international, because it's not just about my white culture. It's about the Black culture. It's about Ethiopia culture, because my son is from Ethiopia. So now we are embracing more communities in our everyday life.
So Jeanette, with that in mind, can you provide me with a broader framework for something that you'd use therapeutically to address these complex issues of transracial families?
What I teach families is, first and foremost, be a true ally for your child. You need to educate them about racism. Acknowledge and validate if there is a racist comment or slur. Acknowledge that your child has a right to be angry and hurt, and this is not okay for anyone to say things that are racist. What I teach is something called Wise Up, which comes from the Center for Adoption and Support in Education. It is a tool, it's an acronym, WISE, which teaches kids that you can walk away if something is said. As a family, you decide, are we going to walk away? I is you say something, you can say it's private, you don't have to answer them. S, you can share something about your story or answer what their question is. And E is you can educate them so that they have tools which are really boundaries if they feel that someone is questioning their transracial family and being a family, and is that really your real mother? Questions that can be very difficult to handle as a family and for children. So children have boundaries, and they can respond in ways where they can keep themselves safe. And then as a family, they can talk about those things together. There's a book called Inside Transracial Adoption by Gail Steinberg and Beth Hall. And one family used the power of brainstorming together about, how do we handle difficult situations in public. And one family practiced staring and would do a public stare in unison when encountering any racism, which helped them together mitigate feelings of any rejection or pain and people questioning their family unit and who they are. So I thought that was very interesting.
What are some of the other strategies you would use to help adoptive parents help their own children deal with racism internally, not externally?
We need to help educate children on what is racism, and that beneath all of our skin, it's teaching children the values of being human. Beneath all of our skin, we all look alike, and we all deserve to be respected, honored, and treated with dignity. That has nothing to do with the color of our skin, that we all are accepted, recognized, honored. We can celebrate diversity in all human beings, and that no one can limit or define you based on the color of your skin, and you can take pride in who you are and your cultural history and being in this world, that you belong and you matter. And that's the piece of self-esteem that is so crucial for an adoptee, to feel a sense of belonging in their family. And really, that's what family is about, feeling heard, validated, acknowledged, and creating positive role models for children. That's the important piece. Parents of families of transracial adoption, you want to interact with people of your child's race. You want to see your child's race represented in your community, in their school. One of the most helpful things for a child of a different race if they were born in another country, is to travel to their birth country so they can see themselves represented and know that they do belong, that they have a place, that there are people like them in the world and they matter.
Speaking as an adoptive parent, I know that there are so many complex issues with children who are adopted. They already are questioning so many aspects of their life. Now, when you add another layer onto this, whether or not they belong racially in a family or whether or not their culture is simpatico with the culture that they've now been adopted into, now I think the complexities get even more layered and deeper and sometimes more serious. Can you address that emotional aspect of transracial adoption?
Yes, it does create a new layer for the child to feel like, do I really belong here and where do I belong? Because I don't see myself represented in my family. So it can feel very isolating. And that's why it's important to integrate that child with their race. Because if we do not, they are going to believe, and this has happened many times when parents aren't mindful of that, that the child will not believe they're of their race. They will start thinking they're white if their parents are white. And they have what's called identity confusion. And that is another layer that can be quite complicated and very overwhelming for the child internally and confusing. And it adds this layer, which is only going to impact their ability to think, receive information, because they will be in high anxiety state of wondering who they are, where they fit in. And a lot of kids will seek out others to gain their identity, and they may not be included in their cultural identity. Because what I found with some adoptees who they may be, you know, Mexican, however, they don't speak Mexican. They were raised in a white Jewish family. And then when they're in their Mexican community, they feel different. They don't feel like they fit in. And the Mexican culture can see that. Because first off, they don't speak the native tongue, and you can tell that they have a different way about them, that they aren't part of the Mexican community. And that can be very daunting and can also create another layer of loss, that am I really a part of my people, or am I, where do I belong? And it feels like this somewhere between, I'm a part of two races, I'm a part of two cultures, and still I don't know where it is that I fit. So that can be very difficult and emotionally challenging because it creates another layer of loss.
We're talking today with Jeanette Yoffe, Executive Director of the Celia Center, and an adoptive parent, Melanie Elliott, about the complexities of transracial adoption. Melanie, tell me a little bit about the internal struggles you might have in your family with regard to this.
With regard to what, dealing with racism?
Not so much external, but in your family unit, back
at home.
In your family
unit? Mm-hmm. Well, it's really interesting. We talk about race. We talk about color. We're trying to do our best to expose our son to the African-American community, but also to the Ethiopian adoptive community. In Los Angeles, I believe there's something like 50,000 Ethiopian expats that live here, and there's Little Ethiopia. And there's also a fairly sizable Ethiopian adoptive community. So we have get-togethers with them, and there's an Ethiopia Cultural Center. When we're available on Saturdays, he goes to class there and learns Amharic, which is the main language in Ethiopia. They learn Ethiopia dance and art, all taught by Ethiopians. So we do our best to expose him. It doesn't replace being in the country, but we do our best to expose him. There are organizations that we're involved with, aside from the Ethiopian adoptive community. There's an organization called PACT in Northern California, and they have a satellite called Kaleidoscope, and those groups are primarily serve to help children adopted of color into transracial families. So we do our best to expose him and educate him about Ethiopia culture, Ethiopia history, all age appropriately, because my son is only 6 right now. But we are also exposing him to American history, Black history. We have a great book that we bought. There was an African-American festival several weeks ago in Leinart Park, and we went there, and there was someone selling books, and there's a book called Our Children Can Soar. And I guess the NAACP gave it an award, but it celebrates Rosa and Barack and Jackie Robinson. So with each page, we can talk to him about who these people are and were, what they represented, so that he can learn about his race.
Do you ever fear that at some point he will say, this culture that I'm living in now does not feel right for me? I need to be with my own people and define people in a way that you might not. Does that ever enter into your consciousness?
Oh, sure. I've been fortunate. When I served on the board of Connecticut, I did a lot of outreach to the Ethiopian adoptive community because Connecticut served primarily Korean adoptees and made up of Korean adult adoptees. And in my outreach, I was able to connect with some adult Ethiopian adoptees who are very big advocates of staying connected to the culture, and feel, some of them do feel strongly that their culture really is and their home really is Ethiopia. So that could happen. And going into an international adoption, our son could grow up, he could major in some sort of something, and he could end up wanting to move back to Ethiopia and live there, and that's okay. We want to celebrate his culture, celebrate who he is, be stewards to him, to teach him not only a positive self-image, but a positive racial identity. And however he identifies himself, we're going to love him because, you know, hopefully he'll have enough self-esteem to embrace who he wants to be and who he is as he grows up.
So let's direct this toward what happens out in public. So, Melanie, how do you handle intrusive questions from strangers and from family? Can you give me some examples of how you might have responded initially as opposed to now?
Sure. Our son had just been home with us for a few months, and I was in a grocery store, and there was a man staring at us. He was a white man, probably in his late 40s maybe, and I was getting a little uncomfortable, and Ben was in the cart, and he was maybe 18 months. So he wasn't cognizant of what was going on, but I approached him and said, can I help you? And it became this wonderful conversation because he assumed that I had a very dark husband, and he did not put the two and two together that my son was adopted. And he opened up to me and said he was a gay man in a interracial relationship, and he and his partner had lots of racism and racist comments, and he was curious to know if that had happened to us. So he was staring at us because of our conspicuousness, but it wasn't from a negative standpoint. And if I had reacted defensively and on guard and how dare you look at my family, it became this really wonderful moment. And then at another time, this was a couple years ago, actually at my son's preschool, one of the part-time app outlets, he was surprised, and my son was playing with friends, so he wasn't privy to the conversation, but this man was, he's like, you're his mom? Like, nobody told him that his mother was white. And then he went on to say, so where'd you get him? And I was like, what? He's like, what store did you get him from? And I was like, oh, you know, thinking to myself internally, this is going to be a nice teaching moment. And it became a nice teaching moment because I just sort of smiled at him and said, oh, you don't say it like that. I know what you were trying. I said, that's totally fine. It's just, we don't refer to it that way. What we say is, where did you adopt him from? What country is he from? So I really tried to make it a teaching moment for him rather than saying my internal monologue of what I really wanted to say. When those kinds of things happen, it really is, first of all, it's a situational thing, so it depends on the instance if there's a question or a comment. Fortunately, we've been spared comments, but I really try to just approach it from a teaching moment, maybe with a little bit of humor. Because wherever it is, if I'm with my son, he's going to pick up on my response. And that was one of the things that we learned in our adoption, pre-adoption training and classes, is that he's going to pick up, and if I come at it from a place of shame or anger, he's going to sense that. But if I come at it from confidence and teaching, it makes a whole world of difference for him, for me, and for the person who's making the interesting comments. It changes the dialogue. It makes it a better conversation, more interesting conversation, when it's a teaching moment rather than defensive and coming at it from a place of shame and anger. My son will pick up on it, and it becomes a good teaching moment, and maybe this man learns not to say those kinds of comments again.
I'm wondering if, as he gets older, I'm guessing at 6 years old, he hasn't been faced with that many social circumstances or things that have happened where people question his racial authenticity. They would question, how could he be of one race and live in a family with another race? Where did he come from? How did he get here? And I am guessing as he gets older, that will change as he ages. So I'm wondering how you help counsel him, and has he already been faced with these circumstances?
I don't think anybody has ever come up to him and said, is she your mom? He was at a playground after school. This was when he was still in preschool. And a little girl came up to me and said, are you his mom? And I said, yes, I am. She said, really? And I said, yes. She said, wow, you know, and it became this conversation. I couched it in six-year-old terms, but I said that he was adopted. And what was really interesting was she got very concerned about him because at the time, this was after school, he was the only person of color there. And she said, does he have friends? Is he going to be okay? And I said, he's going to be just fine. He has a lot of friends that have the same color he has. So he hasn't been exposed to friends talking to him personally. But the things that we do as parents is talk to him about who he is, where he's from, his culture, his heritage. You know, as I talked about, that he is now African American. He is also Ethiopian American. He's also American. So we're just trying to do our best to educate him at his level so that if conversations like that do come up, that we do cover how to respond to something like that when it does.
We have only a few more minutes left, but I would like to talk about white privilege. And that's a very charged term, but it's real. And it's in the news all the time. So I'm wondering, Jeanette, first let's start with you. From a therapeutic point of view, how do you help your clients keep white privilege in check, especially when they deal with the outrage of experiencing racism for the first time?
Yes. So keeping white privilege in check, they do need to go into the community and have respect for their child's racial and cultural community. You know, they may not be accepted right away. It may take time for people to get used to seeing them there as the parent of a person, a child of color. And they do need to educate their children that when their child is not with them, they will be treated differently. And I was a counselor at the PACT camp that Melanie was talking about. And, you know, it's very hard because parents do need to tell their children, you know, when you're with us, you will have that white privilege, and when you're not, it will be different. And it's hard because it is the reality in our society, and I think I just have such respect for transracially adoptive families because they face it every day, and I feel like they're breaking a mold, and they're creating this new society for us that we need to accept. We need to accept each other as people who, despite the color of our skin, we all belong and matter here, and discrimination should not exist anymore. And people deserve equal rights. And I think this is what transracial adoption is doing in our country. It's really fighting this dogma of discrimination. So it's having some very difficult conversations and having, you know, these realistic conversations with your children about this as they get older.
Melanie, do you have any brief thoughts?
Oh, I'd love to add to that. It's interesting what Jeanette was talking about, how this is all, you know, because there are so many transracial adoptive families that the conversation is shifting a little bit. And what's interesting as a byproduct of my husband and I adopting a child of color, that reverberates into our personal community, so that when things happen in, you know, in the news, and we'll leave it at that, that it's causing my friends and our friends to think about our family and to think about how these incidents that happen could possibly affect us. So it's causing other people to think in a different way and think more in terms of, mm-hmm. Continuing the uncomfortable conversations and continuing the dialogue. And, you know, one of the reasons why, you know, PACT and Kaleidoscope are so important and our Ethiopian adoptive community is that, you know, my son is going to grow up with other children and other family units that are like ours and have friends and mentors that are mentors of color so that when things happen, if something does happen, he has tools already ingrained in him that he can call, you know, the counselor at PAC that he met 5 years ago and have a long discussion about if something were to happen. Like, there are, we're getting tools to give to him so that he can be as informed as possible, age appropriately, while growing up.
Sure. Jeanette, what one tip would you like to leave the listeners with today?
Well, I think that even though sometimes adoption is very complex and there's a lot to learn and we're thriving in the adoption community, and I think it's important for us to hear all of the points of view in the triad and connect with one another and help really bridge the connection and compassion so we can hear each other's sides of view and support each other on this journey together.
Melanie?
If someone is thinking of adopting transracially, I would suggest doing the homework and preparing and talking to people who have our transracial adoptive parents who've already had that experience and really listen to their thoughts and really listen to when they ask questions, listen to the answers. Because it isn't for everyone. And sometimes people have these grand ideas about things, but it's important to know the reality of what it is to be a transracial adoptive family, to be a child of color in a transracial family, and to be a transracial adoptive parent. That being said, I wouldn't change a thing for the world. And I'm grateful to be where I am and to have the life that I do.
Sure. We've been talking today with Jeanette Yoffe, Executive Director of the Celia Center, and an adoptive parent, Melanie Elliott, about the complexities of transracial adoption. Jeanette can be found at theceliacenter.org. Melanie Elliott can be found tweeting at mom2TLE and on her blog, mom2TheLittlestE. Thank you both for your wise wisdom and counsel and information.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Thank you.